Friday, February 21st, 2020, Maneco 64, home of alternative economics and contrarian views. So I take no pleasure at seeing all the fiat currencies sink like they're sinking right now versus gold. Yes, I've spoken about sinking fiat currencies since 2007 when I actually wrote an article entitled They're All Sinking, when I used to keep a blog, which I don't do anymore. It was called ForSoundMoney.com. And what I'm seeing now, and I spoke about this last week when the euro started sinking sharply versus gold, when gold was making all-time highs. At the time, it was at 1445. Now we're above 1500 in euros. In the Japanese yen, we're seeing that currency sink. We're near all-time highs, but the all-time highs are from 1980, when you could still buy over, I think, 300 yen with a dollar. Yeah, the Japanese yen is sinking. We're now above 180,000 yen. We're seeing the dollar, U.S. Federal Reserve notes starting to sink. And why don't I take pleasure at this, seeing that I've been right about what's going to come? Well, it wasn't difficult being right, because if you do your history, your monetary history, if you think outside the box, you can see these things coming. Yes, it's not easy to sit there and wait for it. You need to be very patient. But to me, yeah, it's nice that my followers who have gold and silver to some extent are doing well. But to the general public, I think this meltdown of the fiat currencies, what it means is more and more economic hardship ahead, especially for the general public, the 90% who aren't able to protect themselves, like the 1% and those just below them with hard assets, with instruments that protect themselves. The average person, their wages are not going to keep up with the inflation. The cost of living is going to go up, especially with what's going on in Asia. And I'm not going to mention the C word, of course. And it seems to be getting worse. So yeah, I take no pleasure at the sinking currencies. Just going to look at the headlines today quickly to see what is going on out there. Important headlines, for example, in relationship to what's happening in Asia. And this is very serious, of course. I watched a video yesterday one of my viewers sent to me from Richard Duncan a few years ago. Very clever guy. Don't agree 100% with what he has to say. But at the time, I think it was 2016, late 2016, he thought we could keep this fiat money bubble going because we had globalization. There wouldn't be any problem with inflation because the Western countries, according to him, could print and create as much debt as they wanted. And the deflationary effect of globalization through cheaper labor, through cheaper production in the Far East, in Asia, would counter that. But what we're seeing now out there is a threat to that. I spoke a few days ago, and you can listen to that video, about how this event in Asia could affect the global supply chain, just-in-time inventory system. And it could trigger a move by companies in the United States, in the EU, in the UK, to look closer to home, to have their production move closer to home, to not outsource, not to be dependent so much on China for their products. And that would be a good thing, of course, for people in the UK, in the US, but it would mean a lot higher prices because people in the UK, the US, and the EU, they get paid a lot more than the people in China, South Korea, and other countries in Asia. And that could be inflationary. And actually, Richard Duncan said that the threat to the easy money, the money out of thin air, and the fact that the central banks can keep doing this, the only threat would be the curtailment or the end of globalization. Am I saying that's a bad thing? Am I a globalist? I'm not here to judge that. I'm just here to give you what the effects could be. Yes, I think globalization as a whole hasn't been great for the EU, for the US, but of course it's been very good to countries like China and other countries in Asia. It's brought a lot of prosperity to them. They've transformed their economies. We've had to pay it for that to some extent with lower paying jobs here in the UK and the US and elsewhere. So yeah, he thinks that curtailment or an end to globalization could put an end to these continuing low interest rates that we're still seeing and a low inflation, if you want to call it. So what's happening now, I think, is a big threat to that. But at the same time, we're still seeing a lot of deflationary pressures as per the bond market. So it's all very confusing. It says here now as well, in terms of what's happening in Asia, China and South Korea see spikes in relation to that disease. As airlines fear $29 billion global hit from outbreak, you can probably boost that number up. They're always trying to be more positive, these big companies and governments as well. Zero Hedge reporting this morning, South Korean cases of that beer disease, whatever, or cerveza, explode after super spreader event. China reports spike in cases outside that city where it started. So it's not great. So what are we seeing here? Well, in terms of the financial markets and why gold and silver are doing so well, why there's a little bit of negativity in the stock market now, even though I think investors are still complacent. What we're seeing is the bond markets, especially, forecasting a slowdown, and that's not surprising. And I think there's still investors are still behind the curve. We saw the other day the minutes of the last meeting of the Fed. Granted, things weren't as bad back then, but they're very complacent. They're saying that things are okay. But with that, I want to look at the markets and tell you why I think things are getting worse in terms of the world economy, and that's not surprising. Do I think it was completely caused by what's happening in China? No, I think it's just a trigger. Look at Japan. We had Japanese data, I think, last week, and the GDP numbers prior to what's been happening in Asia, they had GDP numbers that translated to a shrinkage of their GDP of 6% per annum. And that was at the tail end of 2019. We had China in 2019 with the lowest GDP growth since 1990. So I think this is just going to accelerate the move lower in growth around the world. Yeah, the central banks are going to get their bazookas out and because that's all they know how to do. It's going to be interesting. So let's look at the markets. It's 10 to 8 a.m. London. So let's look at the usual prices. And then towards the end, I'm going to look at the bond markets and tell you why I think it could change a lot of things. And I'll talk a little bit about the milkshake theory of Brent Johnson, is his name, I think. Yeah, Brent Johnson. So right now, spot gold is at $16,33.50, up $14, just under 1%. High has been $16,35, low has been $16,18. So some people have asked me, are we going to see a pullback in gold? It's possible. The key level, of course, was 1610. We broke out of that, and it's been almost straight up. We could conceivably go back down there and even lower. I would say I have a level as well, longer-term level, as you can see here, around 1583, which is a 61.8 retracement of the correction or bear market, if you want to call it, from 2011 to the end of 2015. I've spoken about this level many times. So we could go back to retest even that level, 1583. Above, to be honest, there's not much resistance, as you can see by the chart. I would say maybe the next resistance would be, strong resistance would be 1800. Am I saying it's going there today? No, but it might not take that long to get there. Spot silver, yeah, silver yesterday was kind of kept down, even though gold went up. What was that all about? Well, I think it's probably a little bit of the powers that be trying to stop gold, so they stop silver. Usually when they do that, though, when gold is doing well and silver is going down, is a harbinger that the next day gold will come down. But as we see, they did not succeed, because gold is up today and silver is up now 1% at 1853. Still very undervalued, silver. So the stock market, yes, yesterday it dropped all of a sudden during the day. It did rebound a lot, but still finished lower. We're now down 180 in the Dow future, down 0.6%. Same thing for the S&P 500, down about 2/3. And the NASDAQ 100 future is down 0.8. I've been following a little bit. As I've told you, you might know, I've been putting some trades on. Yesterday, I took a profit in my calls in silver. I bought some calls in silver last week, 19 call. Yeah, we didn't get to 19, but the market price moved. Nice little profit. But I've got a position now that I added on to yesterday, volatility index calls or VIX calls. There's a wide spread in this spread betting option market for the VIX index. So when you put the trade on, you're already losing. But this is starting to move now, but volatility is still really low. So I think that's something, if you guys are into trading, and I'm not advising here, I think that there's a potential there that the VIX could jump even further. Right now, my position's still down a little bit, but it's up from yesterday when I added on to it. So I expect volatility to pick up. Does that mean I expect a crash? Well, no, a big correction maybe. What about the currencies and the US dollar? Well, the dollar has moved up in terms of the dollar index, mainly because the yen and the euro have been so weak, and those two make about 3/4 of the dollar index. What about the milkshake theory? Well, I listened to Brent Johnson. He did an interview with Peter Schiff. It was quite entertaining. And then I looked into his theory. I listened to what he had to say about the milkshake theory. And one thing that his theory depends on, though, was the Federal Reserve unwinding their balance sheet, raising interest rates. And that's what the Federal Reserve started doing a couple of years ago. And yes, if they had kept going, if they're still unwinding their balance sheet today and raising rates, yeah, the dollar would have been a lot higher. I think, versus all the other currencies. Granted, the dollar is still fairly strong as per the dollar index, but I think, yeah, his milkshake theory is that the milkshake is made up of all the liquidity pumped into the milkshake cup by the central banks. You got yen liquidity, euro liquidity, you got yuan liquidity, sterling liquidity, Swiss franc liquidity, and dollar liquidity. And what he was saying with this theory is that as the Fed took their straw and took out the dollar liquidity from the milkshake, that the dollar would go ballistic. But now the fact that the Fed is actually cut rates last year, they're helping the repo market, they're doing not QE, their balance sheet is increasing again. I think that milkshake theory comes a little bit under threat. But the other thing I would say, it doesn't really matter. Do you really want to have milkshake when you can have fine wine that's maybe healthier for you? Not too much, of course, just a glass a day. I think the fine wine is better than milkshake. And what's the fine wine? Well, it's gold and silver, precious metals. So that's what I have to say about the milkshake theory. Let's finish off and look at the bond markets, because they're very good forecaster of things to come economically. So today, what is raising red flags is the US Treasury market. Treasury yields right now, 1.48, the 10-year. So we're below the effective Fed funds rate, which right now is at 1.59, according to the Federal Reserve Bank of New York. So we have an inversion here in the yield curve from 10-year to 3-month. The 3-month yield right now is 1.58, 10-year at 1.48. This means that the Federal Reserve is behind the curve. They're probably going to have to cut rates. They could even do an interim meeting. That means they could do it out of the blue, emergency meeting. And why would they have an emergency meeting? I think because of what's happening out there in the wider world and the currency markets. So there you go. As I said, to finish off, yes, it's great to see that what I've been talking about is happening. The fact that gold and silver are protecting people. But I take no pleasure in seeing the fiat currencies collapse like they're doing, or melting down like they're doing. And I know fiat currencies are a scam, but 99.9% of the people out there don't know that, and they're gonna get hurt. And I don't like to see the general public get hurt. And that's why I'm gonna keep doing my videos, trying to warn people about this. It's not too late to protect yourself. If you enjoyed this video, make sure you hit the like button. Think about subscribing to the channel if you haven't yet. Please share it far and wide. And you can also follow me on Twitter, Facebook, BitChute, Steemit, and DTube. I wish you all a great day. Take care. Bye.